imagine if someone asked you, if you saw the glass as half empty or half full, you would understand what they're talking about, right? Whether you tend to be an optimist or a pessimist. But I wonder sometimes, what does the glass contain in this little proposition? Does it make a difference? What if you were going to share whatever was in the glass? Does that make a difference, how you see it? Empty, half empty, or half full? Or what if the glass being half full meant that you were blessed in general? Or if it were half empty, that you were needy in general? Or maybe rich and poor? Or maybe half full means choosing to live generously and gratefully, and half empty, resentfully and selfishly. Lots of possibilities. One perspective, the glass is half empty, can lead to one way of living. Just as the other perspective, the glass being half full, can lead to living a radically different way. Yet they're both based on the same objective facts, the same glass, the same contents, whatever it is. What is it that makes us see differently? Jesus tells us a parable in today's gospel reading that speaks to perspective, that is, how we see things. This is the first of a very long string of parables that Jesus relates, or that Matthew relates, that Jesus told, and then Matthew goes on to give his interpretation in many of these. So let's have a little quiz. Go back to Sunday school or confirmation. Why did Jesus tell us these parables? Why did Jesus tell these parables to the crowds? What was he hoping to teach them about? What is he hoping to teach us about? Anybody? There you are, God, about God, God's love and mercy. We sometimes think he's talking about us. We sometimes think he's talking about the church. We sometimes think he's talking about the disciples he was talking to. He's talking about God and God's way, God's path. Jesus was teaching about God's kingdom, and I'm going to put a new word out here. Maybe it isn't new to all of you, but modern scholars sometimes are moving away from using the word kingdom and using the word kingdom. And think about that one. Kingdom of God. How is that different from kingdom? Just something to think about. What is God like? And how are we like in relationship to God? So a traditional interpretation of this, you probably learned in Sunday school. I know I did. Is God is the sower, right, in this. And the seed, and what is that seed that God is sowing? It's God's word, yes? Okay, so in that scenario, what are we? Those of us who are hearing God's word, Matthew tells us in his interpretation that we just read together, those of us who are hearing God's word are the soil. Do we even hear the word, it seems to be asking? And if we do, how deeply do we receive it? Are we distracted by worldly concerns that strangle the word before it has a chance to live richly within us? Or might we be good soil where the word thrives and grows, pushes to burst out of us? We look beyond this traditional understanding of the parable, beyond what even Matthew relates, and this is a good interpretation. This helps us live our lives. But if we stretch a little bit and we remember in other stories that Jesus told, the multiple meanings that are in his parables, think about what if we, when we have received that word richly and deeply, might we not also be sowers? Might we not also be the sowers in this parable? We might be God's agents, God's feet. are called to live, to try to share our faith in word and deed with those whom God places in our paths, to share the love of God so abundantly given to us. Well, that, of course, means doing stuff, right? Not just thinking stuff or believing stuff. It means action. It means reaching out to people. It means serving and caring and risking, all sorts of things like that. Some of you have experienced this. What is the problem, though, if we try to do this? If we try to offer ourselves, our time, our energy, all our caring to others? Well, sometimes, before very long, pretty much immediately sometimes, we're going to start to wonder whether it's worth it. We're going to wonder whether anything of value or meaning is possibly going to come out of all of our efforts. We're going to feel discouraged. Why? Because if I might be right, we will notice that a whole lot of what we do seems to be wasted. Nothing much seems to come of it sometimes. A lot is wasted. We try and we try and a lot doesn't happen. Same time, but sometimes, like I said to the kids 20 years later or something, sometimes things do happen. Well, the first people who heard this story, they knew all about a sower going out to sow seed. They saw it happen, they did it year after year. They knew that seed was usually sown by broadcasting it, right? That is, the farmer would walk along and toss it out in every which direction. The land was plowed later. Have any of you done it this way? Yeah. The land was plowed later after the seed was sown. This means that when you were tossing out seeds, it was pretty much impossible to tell what sort of soil it was landing on. It all looked pretty much the same from the perspective of the sower. There wasn't the time or the talent available to do soil samples and still get the planting done. So everything that Jesus talks about in this story about challenges, thin soil, rocks, fat birds, thorns, weeds, whatever, this was all old news to the people that were listening to him. That was the way it worked. Much, probably most, of what you sowed was wasted. They knew that. So what happens when we put ourselves in the perspective of the sower? All of a sudden, all our scientific knowledge, all our experiences are shot down. Good soil? Well, God spreads the word everywhere. Thrifty? We're to be thrifty? God is generous to a fault. We should count the cost, like I was doing with my seeds. God is extravagant, even wasteful. To sow with this kind of hope and vision is to have the perspective of the kingdom of God. With this vision, you don't mind the rocks or the birds or the thin soil or whatever else may get in the way. All of that stuff just doesn't matter. Swallowed up in the promise, the premise of the whole enterprise. This perspective, this promise of a vast harvest, the harvest to which the prophet Isaiah pointed in our first reading, becomes the heart of this little story. We already know that much of what we do is wasted. We know it very well. We already know what it is like to try and try and try to care make a difference and not get anywhere, or not be noticed, or not succeed. Perhaps worst of all, to not even be appreciated. We know what it's like to reach out a hand and have it slapped away. We know all about that. If this parable is about that, it doesn't have anything very new or interesting to say to us. But instead, if the point of the parable and the point of what we do is that by the grace of God, harvest will be great beyond measure, great beyond imagining, then what God will make of our efforts is more than we can imagine. There will be much wasted, but that's all right. That's all right. The one who sows, and that can be us walking alongside God as partners, called by God, we don't need to worry about those things. We are called to scatter the seed. That is to love and to serve and to trust. The rest will be taken care of. Not because of our abilities as sowers, it's because of the power of God. God's word will, as we heard, accomplish what it purposes. Succeed in the thing for which it was sent, that all people might know the love of God and live in that hope and love. This perspective of hope and confidence is the gift we are given today in this parable. Forget the planting and the sowing in neat rows in well-prepared soil. Forget counting the seeds and planting the harvest based on historical data. We are to love and serve in broadcast fashion. Think about that. You have broadcast, right? Think about the seeds lying everywhere, knowing full well that most of what we do won't amount to anything, that bad things are going to happen, but trusting, nonetheless, in the incomprehensible abundance of the harvest. Casting the seed widely, as God is described as doing, we acknowledge the waste. It might be our favorite seed, our best, most self-sacrificing action, our most clever sermon, maybe that's what I mean, our greatest insight. We'll end up on a rocky path or inside some fat herd. But guess what? That isn't ours to control. It isn't ours to fix. It isn't even ours to worry about. For each one of us individually, we together as the church, we have at our feet fields to walk, and we have seed to sow. And we are called to do that. Today, in this story, we are given the gift of perspective. We can wave at the birds, we can smile at the weeds, because they're not a concern, I'm thinking about a scarecrow. For the love that we offer in the Lord's name is the word of the kingdom, of the being in relationship, being with God. And that word, God promises will not return to God empty. But it shall accomplish what God intends for it, and it will prosper in the thing for which it was sent. Amen.